Sì. All right, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Welcome to CMSC 355. Today we're gonna be talking about design principles. Hope y'all are having a good Friday. Let's see what we can get up to today. All right, just a few announcements for today. A couple things you should keep in mind. Monday is a work day for your projects. That means you should be working either together or individually on your projects, and you should be committing code or otherwise somehow documenting your work on Monday. Remember, while deliverables come out kind of when I decide they should come out, you should always be working on your project because these deliverables may check on whether you have been regularly committing to your project. Remember, regular work on your project is kind of the most important thing for this class. That means just working on it about twice a week for the whole semester. That's how we learn to write software together as a team. Now, just to reiterate, workday, it's good if you get together and talk and things like that, but it's very important also that you do something on the server that allows me to verify that you've done something. So show me the commits on the server. That is the number one thing I want you to do on Monday. Also, on the grades, I wanted to mention one thing on the show me your contributions grade. I had one student very respectfully talk to me about their grade on the show me your contributions, and I had actually marked their grade, I believe, as a, I thought their commits were trivial. Because, I mean, some of them were, they were like deletions and things like that. But there were actually many commits which were not trivial. And this person in particular had actually done a great amount of work. And so I was able to give them their points back that I had initially marked off. So what I want to say here is do not be afraid. If I have made a mistake on your grading and it's a real mistake, like you can show me that your commits weren't trivial, or you did have the right number of commits or something like that, please don't be afraid to talk to me. I am trying to do the best I can to accurately grade everybody. Of course, when there's 94 people, there will be some mistakes. And I got the impression, you know, that maybe I had been a little too harsh about don't come talk to me unless it's a real problem. And I still want to say, don't waste your time on like a point or two. That's not worth talking about. But if it's something where you can really show that you have done the work, and I have somehow marked you off for these like contribution kind of things, please do not hesitate to talk to me about that. Because we want to get these grades right. We want to give people the credit that they deserve. Okay. So there's that. Last time we talked about service-oriented architecture again, and specifically software as a service. Service-oriented architecture is kind of an architectural style. Software as a service is a way to deliver software that uses service-oriented architecture. So we're still kind of talking about design here today. We've talked a little bit about architecture. You know, how you can plan out your app, you know, whether it's a client server, whether it's a service oriented architecture, different types of patterns, different types of styles. We talked about how you can draw your design, how you can communicate it to other people in terms of using UML. And that's a great way to communicate within your team and plan out what you're going to build. Today we're going to be talking about object oriented design and ideas on how to make your code into object-oriented design and patterns on how to do that and ways that people have done that in the past. This will help you just make better object-oriented systems. There's a couple different principles we're going to be going over today that are related to object-oriented design, and these are called the SOLID OOP principles. And these are principles that help kind of keep you on track as you're starting to design objects. Because it's, you know, object-oriented programming is kind of a high-level thing. And these rules or principles help you break it down into a few things that you can do that will help you, you know, make good object-oriented code. They are single responsibility principle, open-close principle, list-cause substitution principle, injection of dependencies, and Demeter principle. And we're going to go over half of these a day and some of these next time. Next time, which is actually next Wednesday. Remember, no class on Monday and no office hours on Monday. So we're going to go over a couple of these today. Depth. So one way to look at this, or one thing that you might want to remember, is you could say classes are solid and methods are SOFA. So just thinking about the methods, let's kind of think only about methods. Methods are short, they do one thing, they have few arguments, few as possible, and have a single level of abstraction. Solid concerns itself with designing the classes itself. And we assume that methods are following this kind of SOFA principle. So we're discussing solid overall, but we assume that methods are short, they do one thing, a few arguments, and a single level of abstraction. Remember that about methods. They themselves need to be simple and follow these rules. Now, with classes, one of the most important principles of classes is that they should have a single responsibility. This is the S in solid. Single responsibility principle, SRP. A class should have one and only one reason to change it. Each responsibility that class have is a possible access of change, let's say, and we only want to have one of these per class. Ways that you can tell whether you have one or not is if you can describe the class's responsibility in less than 25 words. Part of the way that you get good at designing OO designs is you define responsibilities and stick to them, okay? So one example is a user is a moviegoer and an authentication principal and a social network member, and that would be bad, right? You need to have kind of a one user class and have things like authentication and social network membership being in other classes that might be related to that user but are not actually in that user. When you have like a really big class, that's a big tip off. All right, so here's a couple statements. Which of these are true about SRP? If a class respects SRP, methods probably respect SOFA. Or B, if a class methods respect SOFA, class probably respects SRP. SOFA methods are short, do one thing, have few arguments, and a single level. What do you think? A or B? Let me know in the chat. What do you think? I would say probably A as well. So let's go with A. If your class has, you know, a single responsibility, then it's much easier to make methods that are short and do one thing. I have few arguments. Now, if your class becomes complicated and does several different things, then it also becomes harder to make simple methods. So you want to keep your class doing one thing, and then it's easier even to make sure your methods are doing one thing. One of the ways that we can tell that things are kind of getting off track when we're making classes is they have a lack of cohesion. And this is a measure, LCOM, that is commonly used, but it basically is a, you know, mathematical way of determining the lack of cohesion in an object-oriented class. You can calculate it by doing 1 minus the sum of methods of instant variables. So like the number of instance methods that access the ith instant variable divided by the methods times variable. So a class is utterly cohesive if all its methods use all of its fields, which means this equation is true. So if you think about it, if you have instant variables and you have methods that are interacting with those instant variables, that's probably part of one responsibility. But if you have two sets of instance variables and they are operated on in different methods, then that probably means you actually have two different responsibilities. So if you have a high LCOM, you might have a violation of the single responsibility principle. So again, this is how you calculate it if you want to kind of get technical on how to calculate it. And the point is you want to have all methods dealing with the same instant variables before this number starts to go high. If you have, one set of methods that deals with one set of variables and another set of methods that deal with another set of variables, that probably indicates that you have more than one responsibility in this case. Now, so far, let's see if y'all have any questions so far. We talked just a little bit about design principles. What questions do y'all have so far? Yes, somebody's asking, would it be good to know this for the exam? Yes, would be good to know this for the exam, but really at the high level, more than anything. So somebody else is asking, could you explain the last slide more? Let me go back to that. All right, this is the lack of cohesion of methods. way you would calculate this is 1 minus the sum of MVI, where MVI is the number of instant methods that access the ith instant variable. Okay, and that divided by methods times variables. This number, I mean, that's technically how it's calculated. This number is high when you have methods that access different variables, okay? It's low if all the methods use all of the fields, then it's low. In fact, if they use all of the fields, then it's zero, right? So it's just really an indication of how many methods use instant variables. Like, it's just a range, right? So if all methods use all variables, that's great. It's going to be close to zero. If methods use only a few variables, then it's going to be high. All right, any more questions about this? And the question in the chat, sum I would be the number of methods that access each instance variable for all I, and that is right, correct. Any more questions? All right, so what we're gonna do now is just open your, you know, favorite Android Studio or any kind of editor, and I want you to create a text changing class. In this text changing class, you can set, let's say there's some instance fields of what letters you're gonna replace, and you're gonna replace, you can set it up so I'm going to replace all the A's in this string with C's, or all the A's with capital A's. So you want to create a class that you can tell it, hey, replace these with these in the given string. So we're all creating a class. It basically, you know, has like a method or two. What you're going to be able to do is tell it, I want to replace this character in the string with this other character. So replace A with B. And so you want to be able to tell it that's what I want to do. And then you want to be able to call a method that does that replacement on any given string that you send to it. So I want you guys and gals to go ahead and design this. And I want you to upload it here. I'm going to go ahead and put that in the chat. So go ahead and design a class, take a picture of it, upload it right here, and then we're going to talk about it right after y'all do it. I'm going to give you just about 5-6 minutes to do it. Let me know if you have any questions in the chat on what I'm asking for. Again, we're just replace a class that places one character with the other. You can kind of set that up. And then you can go and call this class a bunch of times and send it a string. I can try to place all letters with another letter. Like you set it up, replace with N. Hopefully that gives you kind of a more clear picture of what I'm looking for. Everybody's going to create a class. It's going to have instance variables, the things that you're going to replace.
with, and it's going to have another method. And no, this class is going to have fields. It's going to have fields for the A and the B, for instance, because you can set that once, and then you can call that on a bunch of different strings. So this is a class with at least two fields. This class will have at least two fields. Hit me up in the chat if you are confused, but otherwise, go ahead and do that, and then upload a screenshot right there to that in the link that I provided. Yeah, exactly right, Feng Bao. Exactly right. Yes, Stephen, this is a stream for a VCU class. Hope you're enjoying. Right, and I need y'all to go ahead and make that class and upload screenshots of that class. We're not moving on until at least 10 of y'all do it. So get it, make it happen.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Come here.
Say it, spit it out. What is it exactly? Your pain is the amount cleaning you out. Am I satisfactory? Today I'm thinking about things that are deadly. The way I'm drinking you down, like I wanna drown, like I wanna end me. Step on the glass, staple your tongue. Bury a friend, try to wake up. Cannibal class, killing the sun. Bury a friend, I wanna end me. I wanna end me. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Listen.
Keep you in the dark. What had you expected? Me to make you my art and make you a star and get you connected. I'll meet you in the park. I'll be calm and collected. But we knew right from the start that you'd fall apart, cause I'm too expensive. Your talk would be something that shouldn't be said out loud. Honestly, I thought that I would be dead by now. Calling security, keeping my head held down. Bury the hatchet or bury your friend right now. The debt I owe, gotta sell my soul.
Okay, so we only have one upload so far. I'm happy to wait for longer, but please get those uploaded soon. Uploaded soon.
Step on the glass, staple your tongue. Bury a friend, try to wake up. Cannibal class, killing the sun. Bury a friend, I wanna end me. What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why aren't you scared of me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Good. We're getting enough answers in that we can move on. Thank you guys and gals for doing that. We'll take a quick look. Oops. Quick look at some of those. Let me pull one up. Quick. Right here is kind of like what I expected to see. Oops. Yeah. All right, I think you guys can see that now. Here we see one that is kind of what I expected to see. You can see there is a to replace and a replaced with. You construct it. And you populate these two fields, and then you call the replace method as many times as you want. And with a string,
and it's going to go through there and replace that char, and then return the string with the replacements. That's kind of approximately what I was looking for. There's many variations of this that y'all kind of turned in, and a lot of those variations are totally fine, but this is kind of what I was expecting. Now, with that same class, I want you guys and gals to now add an appending function to it. And this is a function that just, you send it a string, and it appends the word dog to the end of that string, okay? So you send it a string, it appends the word dog to the end of that string, and then returns that string. So that's all this one does, and let's upload a few of those examples right here. And we're going to upload them to the same place. I will give you gals just a few minutes to do that. Please go for it.
You should see me in the crowd. I'm gonna run, there's nothing to hide. Watch me make them bow. One by, one by, one. One by, one by. You should see me in the crowd. Your silence is my favorite sound. Watch me make them bow. One by, one by, one. One by, one by, one.
And I wanted to mention, for those of you that have already done it, you can also make the thing that you append configurable. Like, you can make that another field in the class. So instead of just appending dog, you could append anything that you'd like. So you can make that configurable, and we are uploading to the same link. So everybody upload to the same link. And you can make that configurable. If you don't want to just upload append dog, you can, you know, make it so when you construct the class, you send in whatever you're going to append, or things like that. All right.
What is it about them? I must be missing something. They just keep doing nothing. Too intoxicated to be scared. Better off without them. They're nothing but unstable. Bring ashtrays to the table. And that's about the only thing they share. I'm in the secondhand smoke. Still just drinking. Danny, to feel better. Honda's ignited drives them. Only one who's not stunned. Don't give me a Danny now or ever. Waking up at sundown. They're late to every party. Nobody's ever sorry. Too inebriated now to dance. Morning as they calm down. Their pretty heads are hurting. They're awfully bad at learning. Make the same mistakes. Blame circumstance.
All right, so thank you guys and gals for getting some uploads in there. That's great. We're going to look at just a couple here.
Now, what I want you to notice, here is one right here. Check it out. Does anybody notice something that is different between these two methods and this method? What is the difference between these two methods and this bottom method? Hit me up in the chat. These two methods and this bottom method. So what is the difference between the constructor and this replace method and the bottom method? That is one difference, but let's say it wasn't static. So that's a good answer. Let's say it wasn't static though. There would still be some differences. What is another difference? You guys and gals, just another second to guess. Aha! I'm seeing one answer that I really like. It doesn't access instant variables. Check it out. Do you see the purple here? The to replace and the replace with, the to replace and the replace with. In these top two methods, we are accessing instant variables. In the bottom one, we are not accessing instant variables. Interesting difference. Now, check it out. Let's look at the same thing here. Do you see a difference between this and this method, this replace letter and this method? What do y'all think? What is the difference between the top and the bottom? Exactly the same as with the previous one. Now let's imagine that you could actually configure this dog. There was a third instance variable. There was a string, append equals dog here. And so this would just append that, and you could actually set, you know, that append string. So this would actually use instance variable, as would this. However, how are they different, this one and this one, if they're both accessing instance variables? Anybody got a guess? Why would this one and this one be different if they are still both accessing instance variables? All right, I'll give you all a hint. Well, I'll give you the answer, basically. Here's the difference. All right, they are accessing different instance variables. This one is accessing these two instance variables, whereas this one, if we had a append instance variable, would access a different variable. So they are actually completely unrelated, right? This one accesses this, and this one would access a third variable that's not there. What if we had a new method that was replace letter, but it would just replace backwards, like A with B and B with A? If we had replace letter where it would just, you know, check out, it would change the place of replace here to here. That would be strongly related to this method because they're both using the same instance variables. So they're all very related in functionality. They're all accessing the same instance variables. And again, this one, which is just appending something, would be kind of an unrelated method. And that would be something that would stand out to me. If I was reviewing a class and I saw, hey, this one method accesses this one variable, whereas all the other methods are accessing these variables, both of them. So maybe one of these things is not like the other one, and that one should actually be removed from my class. So that's just a little exercise to show you how you can start to identify which things can and cannot go in your class. If all of your methods are accessing the same variables, good. If they're accessing either no variables or some random variable that's unrelated to the kind of core, bad. Maybe that should not be in there. All right. Thanks for sticking with me. I know that was a lot of work to get into that point, but it helps to do these activities so you get your hands dirty and figure this out for yourself. Now, another principle that we're going to talk about. So remember, we were talking about solid, S-O-L-I-D. Talked about the S, single purpose principle. Okay, so there's one question in the chat I want to address real quick. The question there is, what do we do with the extra method? If it performs a similar operation, does it make sense to create a stupid number of classes that contain singleton methods? No. So, like, there is a balance here, right? You don't just create a bajillion classes. You do try and group things together. And this example was really low level, because I needed something that y'all could do in a very quick amount of time. But in general, of course, you want to group things together in classes with like functionality. If you see something that's not operating on the same core instance variables, it just may be something that you would want to put in another class. And you don't want to go to extremes in terms of creating a bunch of classes. This example that we just went through was a bit contrived because it was something that had to be small enough that we could all do very quickly in class. All right, so now moving on to solid. We did the S, single responsibility principle. Now we're doing the O, open-close principle. We need to be open in a way, meaning if I have a class, I want to be able to always subclass that class. So if I have an account, I want to be able to create a checking account below it, and I want that to be easy to do, but I want to be closed kind of for source modification. So I want to be so you can subclass me easily, but other changes not so much. So let me give you an example here. If you had this output report and you were doing a bunch of cases like this, this is actually not so good, right? Because you can't subclass this easily, because you can't add a new format without changing this particular source code file, right? So we want to be open to extend things without changing this source code file. Better version of this would be if we have a report that has a formatter where we set it, and then we call output report and the formatter takes care of outputting it. Then, you know, we can have all these subclasses that give us reports of different types. And this is a strategy design pattern. So let's look at that one more time. I know I went through that a little fast. Open close principle. We want our class to be open for extension, meaning we can subclass it without doing a lot of source code modification, really any source code modification. We can't do that here because we've hard-coded the case, like the switch statement here, right? Anytime you see a case statement, that's a definite code smell that tells you that you probably should have used inheritance, because that's how you would choose which one of these to use. Instead of doing this, you should, in fact, create a report with a formatter that is either PDF or HTML or whatever, and use this strategy design pattern. So when you're trying to use this open-close principle in practice, you can't close, I guess, all type of changes. So you have to make some choices for sure. That's why we kind of use the Agile methodology, because we can see early on which scenarios we're going to have to kind of, tend towards in our project. If you're going to use this open-close principle, it's really good to be doing it inside of a Agile development, so you can know which scenarios you are going to try and keep open and which scenarios are not quite as interesting for your particular system. So just something to keep in mind when you're actually trying to apply this in practice. Another thing is the, so S is the single responsibility principle. O, the open-close principle, make sure you can extend it without changing the source code. And the L in solid is the Liskov substitution principle. This is attributed to Barbara Liskov, who won the Turing Award, which is like a Nobel Prize in computer science. And she actually pioneered many ideas in object-oriented programming. How many people, by show of hands in the chat, are just like saying yes, have ever heard of the Turing Award? Just out of curiosity. Anybody ever heard of the Turing Award? Say yes in the chat if you have ever heard of the Turing Award. So OJ has, excellent. The Turing Award is, again, just like a Nobel Prize in computer science, because computer science doesn't have the Nobel Prize, and it's a big deal. It just means you did some great research, probably several years ago, and it has led to you getting this prize. All right, so her work on the substitution principle, which is one of the key ideas in object-oriented programming, is a method that works on an instance of type T should also work on any subtype of T. So for instance, if here's a counter example of that. If you had a class bird, which had a fly method, of course, crow would extend bird and the fly method you would expect to work. But however, if you had a class ostrich that extended bird, the fly method would not work, okay? And that would be a problem. So this would be a counterexample of the substitution principle, because you expect all birds to be able to fly. So that's just the idea that if you have a superclass and it has a method, all the subclasses should basically support that, so that you can use it in place of the superclass. It's the substitution principle. If you have any subclasses, like in the accounts and checking accounts and saving accounts example, the superclass is the account. The subclasses are checking and savings, and of course you can get money from either of these, right? The counterexample, as we just went over, is where you couldn't get money from an account. Or in this case, you couldn't get a bird to fly. So it's an ostrich to fly. It's a subclass, but it doesn't support that particular operation. So that is not good. All right. So in summary, we have talked about three things in the solid how you design object-oriented systems. We've talked about single responsibility principle, talked about the open-close principle, and the Liskov substitution principle. The single responsibility, we want our classes to do one thing. We want most of our methods to interact with one set of instance variables. If you find that there are two distinct set of instance variables that you're working with in a class, that's probably a bad sign, and it means like maybe you need to refactor some of those things to another class. The open-close principle, which means we want to be open to having our class subclass, but we want to be closed to making any modifications to that class. The Liskov substitution principle, which is if you have a subclass, you should be able to use it in the place of the superclass at any point. It should support all of the methods of that superclass. So solid, we've gone through S and O and L today. Go through I and D next time. And that is it for the lecture today. I want to go ahead and open up to any questions that y'all might have. Hit me up, any questions you might have. And if you don't have any questions, have a great weekend. Thanks for coming. I'll see you not on Monday, but on Wednesday. Make sure you work on that project on Monday. So hit me up if you got any questions. Somebody's asking in the chat, which of course you can ask the questions in Menti too if you want. Somebody's asking, what's on Monday? On Monday, you are going to be working on your project. It is a project work day. There is no lecture on Monday. And you need to make sure you get some commits or some proof of having done work on Monday. There is no class and there is no office hours on Monday. Schedule meetings with me throughout the week if you need to. All right, I'm going to try. I see this question. I'm going to try and find an example real quick. Find a good example. Okay. Here is a, so this is a great question. Thanks for asking this. It says you should, method should be SOFA. Can you define what single level of abstraction means? Yes, let me put this in the chat. Here is a good link. Ooh, that's a long link. In a sec. Get a read to that. Share this real quick. I think it gives a good example. I'm putting it right in the chat. Here is that example. There you go. And check out, I'll show you the part that I think is good. All right. Here is what I think is really good. Check this out right here. You see how this looks like every step is essentially like the same level, same level of abstraction. You'll see the other examples in this example where there's all kinds of stuff going on inside of methods and, you know, they're not always at the same level. This, for instance, these are like three steps that all are kind of approximately the same and same level of abstraction. They don't have like details in them. When you see calls like this mixed with other like low level computation, I would say that is a mixing of abstraction levels, whereas this is all at the same level. Hope that helps. It is an abstract kind of thing to talk about, but hope that helps you understand a little bit. Do we turn stuff we did on Monday through Gradescoop? No. On Monday, you will just be working. There is no deliverable per se on Monday. You just need to make sure you make a commit on Monday. That may or may not be included in a future deliverable, but I would strongly encourage you to go ahead and make commits on Monday. Hope that makes sense. See any more questions? I'm about to get out of here unless y'all have any more questions. Let me know. Looking like not. So I will see y'all on next Wednesday. Hope y'all have a great weekend.